I do like to be beside the seaside. I've spent most of my life in ministry close to the sea. I can't imagine not being able to get to the sea within a few minutes from my home. I love the sea, the feeling of sand between my toes, the sea water easing aches and pains, but also the crashing of the waves and the awesome power it displays. Sitting on the cliff tops watching a thunderstorm still amazes me. I can't look at the sea without giving thanks to God for his amazing creative power that brought the sea to birth. They filled it with life and purpose. Psalm 104 says, "There is the sea, vast and spacious, teeming with creatures beyond number, living things both large and small." The sea is not just a place of great beauty and power, it's also a place of great danger. The second Sunday in July is Sea Sunday, when we think about and pray for those who work on the sea and those who have dedicated their lives to saving those in peril. As a child from my home, you could see the shipbuilders on the River Tyne, most of whom have now disappeared. But building ships is still in the blood of many along the banks of the Tyne, as it is in other communities across Britain, most of whom are still struggling with the loss of purpose. And on Sea Sunday, we remember them and pray for those damaged communities. I've always lived near to fishing communities, and wherever there's a fishing community, you'll also find stories of danger and disaster. The first disciples were fishermen. They knew the dangers of the sea. Jesus himself calmed a storm that had gripped the disciples with fear. Only the God who created the mighty power of the sea and wind could speak to the storm and bring peace and calm. We pray for peace and calm for those on dangerous sea journeys, those whose livelihoods depend on the sea. We also pray for peace and calm in the lives of those who are struggling through the storms of life. I used to live in Bude in Cornwall, and the Cornish coast was famous for its shipwrecks. I remember visiting Hawker's Hut, built by the vicar of Morwenstow, Robert Stephen Hawker. It's about a mile from his church. He originally built it from driftwood and timber retrieved from shipwrecks. Hawker spent many hours in the hut, writing poems inspired by his view of the Atlantic Ocean. He would also watch from the hut and see boats being wrecked on the rocks below. He would then attempt to rescue them. When Hawker first arrived, many of his community were smugglers and wreckers. He challenged them to change their ways, to become lifesavers, to give a decent burial to those who drowned at sea. I've also lived in North Yorkshire and Cumbria, both where the sea plays a great part in the lives of the community and lifeboats are essential and greatly supported. Now, I live on the Northumberland coast, not far from the home of the famous lifesaver Grace Darling, who as a young woman rescued those shipwrecked on the Forfarshire in 1838. This year is the 100th anniversary of the rescue of the trawlerman from the trawler James B. Graham, which struck rocks on the northern coast of Holy Island during a vicious winter storm in January 1922. despite the terrible weather conditions. All 9 crew members from Hartlepool were rescued thanks to the heroic efforts of the island's lifeboat crew and residents. Some of our church members, descendants of those dedicated men and women. My next door neighbour works for the RNLI. And over the years, many of my friends in Cornwall, Yorkshire, Cumbria, and now Northumberland have been volunteers for the lifeboat crews. Probably one of the most famous shipwrecks of all time happened just off the coast of Malta. That of St. Paul, who was washed ashore and made welcome by the islanders. St. Paul brought Christianity to that tiny island, a faith that is still strong today. I lived on Malta for 5 years, and during that time met many who had been shipwrecked. Crossing the Mediterranean, most of them in unfit boats. I'll never forget being involved in a funeral service for 800 migrants who had died at sea, with just a handful of coffins for those whose bodies had been found. Our church supported MOAS, a rescue charity that saved the lives of thousands. Every year on Sea Sunday, I give thanks for their work and pray for those who still make that perilous journey in the faint hope of a better life. If this summer you spend a day beside the sea, please take a few minutes to give thanks to God for his awesome power in creation. Then pray for those whose livelihoods still depend on the sea. Struggling fishing communities, shipbuilders, and areas where shipbuilding has now ceased. Those who work on the trawlers, container ships, and even cruise liners. To remember those who have lost their lives in sea disasters, and those who are risking their lives, trying to cross the seas in unsuitable vessels, hoping for a better life. Finally, give thanks for the work of RNLI and other charities who are committed to saving lives and those who dedicate their lives to the service of others in this way. So let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your awesome creative power, for the wonder of the sea and oceans, the power of the waves. And we give thanks for all that you have given to us. We pray for those whose lives are dependent upon the sea, for those who risk danger day by day. And we pray that you will be close to them. We ask for your protection on those who dedicate their lives to saving others, the volunteers on the many lifeboats, and the work of RNLI. We pray for others who are going through the storms of life at this time, and we pray that as they reach out to you, they may find peace, hope, and the rescue they need. So we bring you these prayers in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.